This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Anne of the Island. Author, Lucy Maud Montgomery. Chapter 1, The Shadow of Change. "Harvest is ended and summer is gone," quoted Anne Shirley, gazing across the shorn fields dreamily. She and Diana Barry had been picking apples in the Green Gables orchard, but were now resting from their labors in a sunny corner, where airy fleets of thistledown drifted by on the wings of a wind that was still summer sweet with the incense of ferns in the haunted wood. But everything in the landscape around them spoke of autumn. The sea was roaring hollowly in the distance, the fields were bare and sere, scarfed with golden rod, the brook valley below Green Gables overflowed with asters of ethereal purple, and the lake of shining waters was blue, 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 not the changeful blue of spring, nor the pale azure of summer, but a clear, steadfast, serene blue, as if the water were past all moods and tenses of emotion and had settled down to a tranquility unbroken by fickle dreams. "It has been a nice summer," said Diana, twisting the new ring on her left hand with a smile. "And Miss Lavendar's wedding seemed to come as a sort of crown to it. I suppose Mr. and Mrs. Irving are on the Pacific coast now. It seems to me they have been gone long enough to go around the world," sighed Anne. "I can't believe it is only a week since they were married. Everything has changed. Miss Lavendar and Mr. and Mrs. Allen gone. How lonely the manse looks with the shutters all closed. I went past it last night, and it made me feel as if everybody in it had died. We'll never get another minister as nice as Mr. Allen," said Diana with gloomy conviction. "I suppose we'll have all kinds of supplies this winter, and half the Sundays no preaching at all. And you and Gilbert gone, it will be awfully dull." "Fred will be here," insinuated Anne slyly. "When is Mrs. Lynde going to move up?" asked Diana, as if she had not heard Anne's remark. "Tomorrow. I'm glad she's coming, but it will be another change. Marilla and I cleared everything out of the spare room yesterday. Do you know, I hated to do it. Of course it was silly, but it did seem as if we were committing sacrilege. That old spare room has always seemed like a shrine to me. When I was a child, I thought it the most wonderful apartment in the world. You remember what a consuming desire I had to sleep in a spare room bed, but not the Green Gables spare room. Oh no, never there. It would have been too terrible. I couldn't have slept a wink from awe. I never walked through that room when Marilla sent me in on an errand. No, indeed, I tiptoed through it and held my breath, as if I were in church, and felt relieved when I got out of it. The pictures of George Whitefield and the Duke of Wellington hung there, one on each side of the mirror, and frowned so sternly at me all the time I was in, especially if I dared peep in the mirror, which was the only one in the house that didn't twist my face a little. I always wondered how Marilla dared houseclean that room. And now it's not only cleaned but stripped bare. George Whitefield and the Duke have been relegated to the upstairs hall. So passes the glory of this world," concluded Anne, with a laugh in which there was a little note of regret. "It is never pleasant to have our old shrines desecrated, even when we have outgrown them." "I'll be so lonesome when you go," moaned Diana for the 100th time. "And to think you go next week." "But we're together still," said Anne cheerily. "We mustn't let next week rob us of this week's joy. I hate the thought of going myself. Home and I are such good friends. Talk of being lonesome. It's I who should groan. You'll be here with any number of your old friends, and Fred. While I shall be alone among strangers, not knowing a soul." "Except Gilbert and Charlie Sloane," said Diana, imitating Anne's italics and slyness. "Charlie Sloane will be a great comfort, of course," agreed Anne sarcastically, whereupon both those irresponsible damsels laughed. Diana knew exactly what Anne thought of Charlie Sloane, but despite sundry confidential talks, she did not know just what Anne thought of Gilbert Blythe. To be sure, Anne herself did not know that. "The boys may be boarding at the other end of Kingsport, for all I know," Anne went on. "I am glad I'm going to Redmond, and I am sure I shall like it after a while. But for the first few weeks I know I won't. I shan't even have the comfort of looking forward to the weekend visit home, as I had when I went to Queens. Christmas will seem like 1,000 years away. Everything is changing, or going to change, said Diana sadly. I have a feeling that things will never be the same again, Anne. We have come to a parting of the ways, I suppose, said Anne thoughtfully. We had to come to it. Do you think, Diana, that being grown up is really as nice as we used to imagine it would be when we were children? I don't know, there are some nice things about it, answered Diana, again caressing her ring with that little smile which always had the effect of making Anne feel suddenly left out and inexperienced. But there are so many puzzling things, too. Sometimes I feel as if being grown up just frightened me, and then I would give anything to be a little girl again. I suppose we'll get used to being grown up in time, said Anne cheerfully. There won't be so many unexpected things about it by and by, though after all, I fancy it's the unexpected things that give spice to life. We're 18, Diana. In 2 more years, we'll be 20. When I was 10, I thought 20 was a green old age. In no time, you'll be a staid, middle-aged matron, and I shall be nice old maid Aunt Anne coming to visit you on vacations. You'll always keep a corner for me, won't you, dee darling? Not the spare room, of course. Old maids can't aspire to spare rooms, and I shall be as humble as Uriah Heep, and quite content with a little over the porch or off the parlor cubbyhole. What nonsense you do talk, Anne, laughed Diana. You'll marry somebody splendid and handsome and rich, and no spare room in Avonlea will be half gorgeous enough for you, and you'll turn up your nose at all the friends of your youth. That would be a pity. My nose is quite nice, but I fear turning it up would spoil it, said Anne, patting that shapely organ. I haven't so many good features that I could afford to spoil those I have. So, even if I should marry the King of the Cannibal Islands, I promise you I won't turn up my nose at you, Diana. With another gay laugh, the girls separated, Diana to return to Orchard Slope, Anne to walk to the post office. She found a letter awaiting her there, and when Gilbert Blythe overtook her on the bridge over the Lake of Shining Waters, she was sparkling with the excitement of it. Priscilla Grant is going to Redmond too, she exclaimed. Isn't that splendid? I hoped she would, but she didn't think her father would consent. He has, however, and we're to board together. I feel that I can face an army with banners, or all the professors of Redmond in one fell phalanx, with a chum like Priscilla by my side. I think we'll like Kingsport, said Gilbert. It's a nice old burg, they tell me, and has the finest natural park in the world. I've heard that the scenery in it is magnificent. I wonder if it will be, can be, any more beautiful than this, murmured Anne, looking around her with the loving, enraptured eyes of those to whom home must always be the loveliest spot in the world, no matter what fairer lands may lie under alien stars. They were leaning on the bridge of the old pond, drinking deep of the enchantment of the dusk, just at the spot where Anne had climbed from her sinking dory on the day Elaine floated down to Camelot. The fine empurpling dye of sunset still stained the western skies, but the moon was rising and the water lay like a great silver dream in her light. Remembrance wove a sweet and subtle spell over the two young creatures. "You are very quiet, Anne," said Gilbert at last. I'm afraid to speak or move for fear all this wonderful beauty will vanish just like a broken silence, breathed Anne. Gilbert suddenly laid his hand over the slender white one lying on the rail of the bridge. His hazel eyes deepened into darkness, his still boyish lips opened to say something of the dream and hope that thrilled his soul. But Anne snatched her hand away and turned quickly. The spell of the dusk was broken for her. I must go home, she exclaimed with a rather overdone carelessness. Marilla had a headache this afternoon, and I'm sure the twins will be in some dreadful mischief by this time. I really shouldn't have stayed away so long. She chattered ceaselessly and inconsequently until they reached the Green Gables lane. Poor Gilbert hardly had a chance to get a word in edgewise. Anne felt rather relieved when they parted. There had been a new, secret self-consciousness in her heart with regard to Gilbert, ever since that fleeting moment of revelation in the Garden of Echo Lodge. Something alien had intruded into the old, perfect, school-day comradeship. Something that threatened to mar it. "I never felt glad to see Gilbert go before," she thought, half resentfully, half sorrowfully, as she walked alone up the lane. "Our friendship will be spoiled if he goes on with this nonsense. It mustn't be spoiled, I won't let it. Oh, why can't boys be just sensible?" Anne had an uneasy doubt that it was not strictly sensible that she should still feel on her hand the warm pressure of Gilbert's, as distinctly as she had felt it for the swift second his had rested there, and still less sensible that the sensation was far from being an unpleasant one, very different from that which had attended a similar demonstration on Charlie Sloane's part when she had been sitting out a dance with him at a White Sands party 3 nights before. Anne shivered over the disagreeable recollection. But all problems connected with infatuated swains vanished from her mind when she entered the homely, unsentimental atmosphere of the Green Gables kitchen, where an 8-year-old boy was crying grievously on the sofa. "What is the matter, Davy?" asked Anne, taking him up in her arms. "Where are Marilla and Dora?" "Marilla's putting Dora to bed," sobbed Davy, "and I'm crying 'cause Dora fell down the outside cellar steps heels overhead and scraped all the skin off her nose and—" "Oh, well, don't cry about it, dear. Of course, you are sorry for her, but crying won't help her any. She'll be all right tomorrow. Crying never helps anyone, Davy boy, and—" "I ain't crying 'cause Dora fell down cellar," said Davy, cutting short Anne's well-meant preachment with increasing bitterness. "I'm crying 'cause I wasn't there to see her fall. I'm always missing some fun or other, seems to me." "Oh, Davy." Anne choked back an unholy shriek of laughter. "Would you call it fun to see poor little Dora fall down the steps and get hurt?" "She wasn't much hurt," said Davy defiantly. "Course if she'd been killed, I'd have been real sorry, Anne. But the Keiths ain't so easy killed. They're like the Blewitts, I guess. Blewitt fell off the hayloft last Wednesday and rolled right down through the turnip chute into the box stall where they had a fearful wild cross horse and rolled right under his heels. And still he got out alive, with only 3 bones broke. Mrs. Lynde says there are some folks you can't kill with a meat axe. Is Mrs. Lynde coming here tomorrow, Anne?" "Yes, Davy, and I hope you'll be always very nice and good to her." "I'll be nice and good. But will she ever put me to bed at nights, Anne?" "Perhaps." "Why?" "'Cause," said Davy very decidedly, "if she does, I won't say my prayers before her like I do before you, Anne." "Why not?" "'Cause I don't think it would be nice to talk to God before strangers, Anne. Dora can say hers to Mrs. Lynde if she likes, but I won't. I'll wait till she's gone and then say 'em. Won't that be all right, Anne?" "Yes, if you are sure you won't forget to say them, Davy boy." "Oh, I won't forget, you bet. I think saying my prayers is great fun. But it won't be as good fun saying them alone as saying them to you. I wish you'd stay home, Anne. I don't see what you want to go away and leave us for." "I don't exactly want to, Davy, but I feel I ought to go." "If you don't want to go, you needn't. You're grown up. When I'm grown up, I'm not going to do one single thing I don't want to do, Anne." "All your life, Davy, you'll find yourself doing things you don't want to do." "I won't," said Davy flatly. "Catch me. I have to do things I don't want to now, 'cause you and Marilla'll send me to bed if I don't. But when I grow up, you can't do that, and there'll be nobody to tell me not to do things. Won't I have the time? Say, Anne, Milty Boulter says his mother says you're going to college to see if you can catch a man. Are you, Anne? I want to know." For a second, Anne burned with resentment. Then she laughed, reminding herself that Mrs. Boulter's crude vulgarity of thought and speech could not harm her. "No, Davy, I'm not. I'm going to study and grow and learn about many things." "What things?" "Shoes and ships and sealing wax and cabbages and kings," quoted Anne. "But if you did want to catch a man, how would you go about it?" "I want to know," persisted Davy, for whom the subject evidently possessed a certain fascination. "You'd better ask Mrs. Boulter," said Anne thoughtlessly. I think it's likely she knows more about the process than I do. I will the next time I see her, said Davy gravely. Davy? If you do, cried Anne, realizing her mistake. But you just told me to, protested Davy aggrieved. It's time you went to bed, decreed Anne, by way of getting out of the scrape. After Davy had gone to bed, Anne wandered down to Victoria Island and sat there alone, curtained with fine-spun moonlit gloom, while the water laughed around her in a duet of brook and wind. Anne had always loved that brook. Many a dream had she spun over its sparkling water in days gone by. She forgot lovelorn youths and the cayenne speeches of malicious neighbors and all the problems of her girlish existence. In imagination, she sailed over storied seas that washed the distant shining shores of fairy lands forlorn, where lost Atlantis and Elysium lie with the evening star for pilot, to the land of heart's desire. And she was richer in those dreams than in realities, for things seen pass away, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Chapter 2, Garlands of Autumn. The following week sped swiftly, crowded with innumerable last things, as Anne called them. Goodbye calls had to be made and received, being pleasant or otherwise, according to whether callers and called upon were heartily in sympathy with Anne's hopes, or thought she was too much puffed up over going to college and that it was their duty to take her down a peg or two. The AVIS gave a farewell party in honor of Anne and Gilbert one evening at the home of Josie Pye. Choosing that place, partly because Mr. Pye's house was large and convenient, partly because it was strongly suspected that the Pye girls would have nothing to do with the affair if their offer of the house for the party was not accepted. It was a very pleasant little time, for the Pye girls were gracious and said and did nothing to mar the harmony of the occasion, which was not according to their wont. Josie was unusually amiable, so much so that she even remarked condescendingly to Anne. Your new dress is rather becoming to you, Anne. Really, you look almost pretty in it. How kind of you to say so, responded Anne with dancing eyes. Her sense of humor was developing, and the speeches that would have hurt her at 14 were becoming merely food for amusement now. Josie suspected that Anne was laughing at her behind those wicked eyes, but she contented herself with whispering to Gertie as they went downstairs that Anne Shirley would put on more airs than ever now that she was going to college, you'd see. All the old crowd was there, full of mirth and zest and youthful lightheartedness. Diana Barry, rosy and dimpled, shadowed by the faithful Fred. Jane Andrews, neat and sensible and plain. Ruby Gillis, looking her handsomest and brightest in a cream silk blouse with red geraniums in her golden hair. Gilbert Blythe and Charlie Sloane, both trying to keep as near the elusive Anne as possible. Carrie Sloane, looking pale and melancholy because, so it was reported, her father would not allow Oliver Kimball to come near the place. Moody Spurgeon McPherson, whose round face and objectionable ears were as round and objectionable as ever. And Billy Andrews, who sat in a corner all the evening, chuckled when anyone spoke to him, and watched Anne Shirley with a grin of pleasure on his broad, freckled countenance. Anne had known beforehand of the party, but she had not known that she and Gilbert were, as the founders of the society, to be presented with a very complimentary address and tokens of respect, in her case a volume of Shakespeare's plays, in Gilbert's a fountain pen. She was so taken by surprise and pleased by the nice things said in the address, read in Moody Spurgeon's most solemn and ministerial tones, that the tears quite drowned the sparkle of her big gray eyes. She had worked hard and faithfully for the AVIS, and it warmed the cockles of her heart that the members appreciated her efforts so sincerely. And they were all so nice and friendly and jolly, even the Pye girls had their merits. At that moment Anne loved all the world. She enjoyed the evening tremendously, but the end of it rather spoiled all. Gilbert again made the mistake of saying something sentimental to her as they ate their supper on the moonlit veranda, and Anne, to punish him, was gracious to Charlie Sloane and allowed the latter to walk home with her. She found, however, that revenge hurts nobody quite so much as the one who tries to inflict it. Gilbert walked airily off with Ruby Gillis, and Anne could hear them laughing and talking gaily as they loitered along in the still, crisp autumn air. They were evidently having the best of good times, while she was horribly bored by Charlie Sloane, who talked unbrokenly on, and never even by accident, said one thing that was worth listening to. Anne gave an occasional absent yes or no, and thought how beautiful Ruby had looked that night, how very goggly Charlie's eyes were in the moonlight, worse even than by daylight, and that the world somehow wasn't quite such a nice place as she had believed it to be earlier in the evening. "I'm just tired out, that is what is the matter with me," she said when she thankfully found herself alone in her own room. And she honestly believed it was. But a certain little gush of joy, as from some secret unknown spring, bubbled up in her heart the next evening when she saw Gilbert striding down through the haunted wood and crossing the old log bridge with that firm, quick step of his. So Gilbert was not going to spend this last evening with Ruby Gillis after all. "You look tired, Anne," he said. "I am tired, and worse than that, I'm disgruntled. I'm tired because I've been packing my trunk and sewing all day. But I'm disgruntled because 6 women have been here to say goodbye to me, and every one of the 6 managed to say something that seemed to take the color right out of life and leave it as gray and dismal and cheerless as a November morning." "Spiteful old cats," was Gilbert's elegant comment. "Oh no, they weren't," said Anne seriously. "That is just the trouble. If they had been spiteful cats, I wouldn't have minded them. But they are all nice, kind, motherly souls, who like me and whom I like, and that is why what they said or hinted had such undue weight with me. They let me see they thought I was crazy going to Redmond and trying to take a BA, and ever since I've been wondering if I am." Mrs. Peter Sloane sighed and said she hoped my strength would hold out till I got through, and at once I saw myself a hopeless victim of nervous prostration at the end of my 3rd year. Mrs. Eben Wright said it must cost an awful lot to put in 4 years at Redmond, and I felt all over me that it was unpardonable of me to squander Marilla's money and my own on such a folly. Mrs. Jasper Bell said she hoped I wouldn't let college spoil me, as it did some people, and I felt in my bones that the end of my 4 Redmond years would see me a most insufferable creature, thinking I knew it all and looking down on everything and everybody in Avonlea. Mrs. Elisha Wright said she understood that Redmond girls, especially those who belonged to Kingsport, were dreadful dressy and stuck up, and she guessed I wouldn't feel much at home among them. And I saw myself, a snubbed, dowdy, humiliated country girl, shuffling through Redmond's classic halls in Copperton boots. Anne ended with a laugh and a sigh commingled. With her sensitive nature, all disapproval had weight, even the disapproval of those for whose opinions she had scant respect. For the time being, life was savorless, and ambition had gone out like a snuffed candle. "You surely don't care for what they said," protested Gilbert. "You know exactly how narrow their outlook on life is, excellent creatures though they are. To do anything they have never done is anathema maranatha. You are the first Avonlea girl who has ever gone to college, and you know that all pioneers are considered to be afflicted with moonstruck madness." "Oh, I know. But feeling is so different from knowing. My common sense tells me all you can say, but there are times when common sense has no power over me. Common nonsense takes possession of my soul. Really, after Mrs. Elisha went away, I hardly had the heart to finish packing." "You're just tired, Anne. Come, forget it all and take a walk with me, a ramble back through the woods beyond the marsh. There should be something there I want to show you." "Should be. Don't you know if it is there?" "No. I only know it should be, from something I saw there in spring. Come on. We'll pretend we are 2 children again, and we'll go the way of the wind." They started gaily off. Anne, remembering the unpleasantness of the preceding evening, was very nice to Gilbert. And Gilbert, who was learning wisdom, took care to be nothing save the schoolboy comrade again. Mrs. Lynde and Marilla watched them from the kitchen window. "That'll be a match some day," Mrs. Lynde said approvingly. Marilla winced slightly. In her heart she hoped it would, but it went against her grain to hear the matter spoken of in Mrs. Lynde's gossipy matter-of-fact way. "They're only children yet," she said shortly. Mrs. Lynde laughed good-naturedly. "Anne is 18. I was married when I was that age. We old folks, Marilla, are too much given to thinking children never grow up, that's what. Anne is a young woman and Gilbert's a man, and he worships the ground she walks on, as anyone can see. He's a fine fellow, and Anne can't do better. I hope she won't get any romantic nonsense into her head at Redmond. I don't approve of them coeducational places, and never did, that's what. I don't believe, concluded Mrs. Lynde solemnly, that the students at such colleges ever do much else than flirt. They must study a little, said Marilla with a smile. Precious little, sniffed Mrs. Rachel. However, I think Anne will. She never was flirtatious. But she doesn't appreciate Gilbert at his full value, that's what. Oh, I know girls. Charlie Sloane is wild about her too, but I'd never advise her to marry a Sloane. The Sloanes are good, honest, respectable people, of course. But when all's said and done, they're Sloanes. Marilla nodded. To an outsider, the statement that Sloanes were Sloanes might not be very illuminating, but she understood. Every village has such a family, good, honest, respectable people they may be, but Sloanes they are and must ever remain, though they speak with the tongues of men and angels. Gilbert and Anne, happily unconscious that their future was thus being settled by Mrs. Rachel, were sauntering through the shadows of the haunted wood. Beyond, the harvest hills were basking in an amber sunset radiance, under a pale, aerial sky of rose and blue. The distant spruce groves were burnished bronze, and their long shadows barred the upland meadows. But around them a little wind sang among the fir tassels, and in it there was the note of autumn. This wood really is haunted now, by old memories, said Anne, stooping to gather a spray of ferns bleached to waxen whiteness by frost. It seems to me that the little girls Diana and I used to be play here still, and sit by the dryad's bubble in the twilights, trysting with the ghosts. Do you know, I can never go up this path in the dusk without feeling a bit of the old fright and shiver. There was one especially horrifying phantom which we created, the ghost of the murdered child that crept up behind you and laid cold fingers on yours. I confess that to this day, I cannot help fancying its little furtive footsteps behind me when I come here after nightfall. I'm not afraid of the white lady, or the headless man or the skeletons, but I wish I had never imagined that baby's ghost into existence. How angry Marilla and Mrs. Barry were over that affair, concluded Anne with reminiscent laughter. The woods around the head of the marsh were full of purple vistas, threaded with gossamers. Past a dour plantation of gnarled spruces and a maple-fringed, sun-warm valley, they found the something Gilbert was looking for. Ah, here it is, he said with satisfaction. An apple tree, and away back here, exclaimed Anne delightedly. Yes, a veritable apple-bearing apple tree too, here in the very midst of pines and beeches, a mile away from any orchard. I was here one day last spring and found it, all white with blossom. So I resolved I'd come again in the fall and see if it had been apples. See, it's loaded. They look good too, tawny as russets but with a dusky red cheek. Most wild seedlings are green and uninviting. I suppose it sprang years ago from some chance-sown seed, said Anne dreamily. And how it has grown and flourished and held its own here all alone among aliens, the brave determined thing. Here's a fallen tree with a cushion of moss. Sit down, Anne, it will serve for a woodland throne. I'll climb for some apples. They all grow high, the tree had to reach up to the sunlight. The apples proved to be delicious. Under the tawny skin was a white, white flesh, faintly veined with red, and besides their own proper apple taste, they had a certain wild, delightful tang no orchard-grown apple ever possessed. The fatal apple of Eden couldn't have had a rarer flavor, commented Anne. But it's time we were going home. See, it was twilight 3 minutes ago and now it's moonlight. What a pity, we couldn't have caught the moment of transformation. But such moments never are caught, I suppose. Let's go back around the marsh and home by way of Lover's Lane. Do you feel as disgruntled now as when you started out, Anne? Not I. Those apples have been as manna to a hungry soul. I feel that I shall love Redmond and have a splendid 4 years there. And after those 4 years, what? Oh, there's another bend in the road at their end, answered Anne lightly. I've no idea what may be around it. I don't want to have. It's nicer not to know. Lover's Lane was a dear place that night, still and mysteriously dim in the pale radiance of the moonlight. They loitered through it in a pleasant...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.